Welcome back to Legendary Series. Reynad, well spoken as always.
Isn't he just so chipper?
He is.
It's awesome.
Really is.
Yeah, just like a positive beam of sunshine on a cloudy day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Really the heart of Tempo Storm.
My Ray. Yeah.
Well, we are about to jump into the match between Reynad and Domdus.
That's right. I'm pretty excited to see how Domdus is going to do up against Reynad, who seems to be kind of like up and down a lot of times in his play, but in his results. But if there's one thing that you can kind of pinpoint is that Reynad has been playing well.
Yeah.
His last performances, if you even look at Gfinity, his last offline performance outside, you know, the Aces Streamathon thing, the Marathon doesn't really necessarily count for tournament play.
Yeah.
It's more like a ladder approach and strategy. But if you look at the last time Reynad competed in Gfinity, a lot of the players there were saying Reynad would play perfectly. And they felt like, you know, round of eight didn't exactly do justice because they thought he probably played the best out of everybody in that tournament outside of Firebat. And, like, they could have easily seen Reynad versus Firebat based off the way it was going on. So if Reynad's playing very well and, you know, he has a really good team to help him with, like, a bunch of practice, the question is, does he have a really good team to support him. What's the thing that's holding him back here? And I think a lot has to do with his lineup. I think Reynad in the past always brought decks that were a little too fancy sometimes for his own good. And I mean, it's one of those things where it's not even necessarily as fancy, but sometimes you just try to predict too hard.
Yeah.
Like Savitz, for example, bringing three aggro decks to try to punish. That got exposed really fast, and then as a result, he can actually win his week, even though Savitz is a great player.
Still made it to the finals.
Phenomenal.
Despite a lot of players sort of not countering it, but realizing, calling his bluff like really quickly with the three aggro decks.
So, you know, I'm curious to see what the lineup is. I mean, he was really back and forth. I think he was, like, tossing around the idea of bringing Mage. He said he really liked Hunter, and he really wanted to bring Warlock. Mm-hmm. But he was also tossing the possibility of Warrior. So it's like, you know, all these different things. Meanwhile, Domdus, what do you know about him, TJ?
All right, so Domdus, he is I had a chance to talk to him for a long time. Now, a lot of times I'll try and have a conversation with the players, but they're usually busy, like, creating their decks for the week. Because we don't have that much time between the end of the Challenger Cup and it's like 4 days usually, and a lot of times they're busy practicing.
Sure.
But Domdus actually talked to me for a long time. We had a lot of conversations. He's a really friendly guy.
With and a really glass of wine.
Exactly. We had a date. We went out to eat dinner
at that fireplace actually right here.
Exactly.
And then you slayed him with the sword. You cut his head off.
No, but
this is the part where TJ rips off the mask and realizes that he's Domdus and he's playing against Reynad. And that he's been scouting the entire time using me as his homunculus.
That would be the ultimate ruse.
But yes, please tell me more about Domdus, a.k.a. TJ Sanders.
He's a smart dude. He graduated from UC Irvine. Mm-hmm. He is about to go into med school.
Cool.
And he's
works a very smart guy.
Though. Yeah, he works as a lead researcher at the UCI Medical Center for the Department of Surgery. Yeah, and he's 23.
And he plays Hearthstone.
And he's actually really good at Hearthstone. he is on Team Magic Amy. He actually knows.
You're joking me.
I'm not joking. Trey is one of his best friends. He went to middle school and high school.
That makes sense. With Trey lives in Irvine.
Yeah, yeah. Right. So they know each other in real life. Trey, we actually saw in the Legendary Series a couple weeks ago. Mm-hmm. So they're very, very close. And, of course, Trey's still rocking the Magic Amy tag as well. It's mostly just a group of friends that still just want to rock that name.
It's just, you know, it's a little bit sad because the Legendary Series is through where Magic Amy made her claim to fame when she performed excellently and qualified for what eventually became quite a disaster in terms of PR.
Yeah, but the week that she participated was fantastic.
If there's one thing in common is that the people on that team are a list of killers. You had Silent Storm, who used to be there, of course. Torre got a top 8 at BlizzCon, very great. Tom Fleur, a very strong player indeed. Mm-hmm. And just basically people on that team were very talented players overall.
Yeah.
And, you know, no exception, Magic Amy, despite everything had happened, you know, the play that we saw in the Legendary Series was phenomenal as well. People were saying, like, a top handlock player. I'm setting pretty high expectations here for Domdus.
Yeah.
I think he can definitely take down Reynad here.
Yeah, he definitely showed a lot in his open qualifier. The funny story is he was actually at a family gathering the entire time he was playing in the Challenge Cup. He was walking around a family gathering with his iPad, playing Hearthstone on his iPad, winning the tournament while he was walking around his family gathering winning. So it's a pretty funny story. And you can see their decks on the screen. Paladin. That's the first Paladin we've seen today, and I think that might be the only Paladin we are going to see.
Paladin, Druid, and Warrior. Now, we do see Warlock, Druid, and Warrior. So the only differences between these two players are that Warlock and that Paladin. Now, I kind of have to think that Reynad's going to play Zoo here. I know he really likes Handlock, but I think the team in general has been back and forth on Handlock. I think they say if you play Handlock perfectly, you can outbeat the Zoo in terms of almost everything. Mm-hmm. But it's just so hard to play Handlock perfectly. Yeah. While Zoo playing perfectly is definitely still pretty tough nowadays because of a lot of the advanced decision making. But it's less punishing to not be as perfect. Because Handlock, as you saw, sometimes you just die.
Yeah.
Just straight up.
That's true. And that's one of the frustrations that a lot of Handlock players have. Now, a lot of people associate Reynad with Zoo because, the father of Zoo, the father of Hearthstone. But Reynad's claim to fame was sort of his Handlock. When he first started streaming on Twitch when he was playing Hearthstone, he was almost an exclusive Handlock player. Maybe not exclusively, but it was by far his most played deck. That was a long time ago, back before even the official release of Hearthstone. Reynad only got a couple hundred, maybe a couple thousand viewers on Twitch. And so he's actually played that deck.
The good old days.
Since before Zoo. Yeah, the good old days. Back when Reynad actually was chipper.
Yeah, yeah, back when he actually tried and he was providing excellent commentary.
Still gave rants, but they were the rants were a little bit more positive and passion-filled. Well, maybe not positive, but...
Nah, it's definitely become more of like a fun thing for Reynad.
Yeah.
Even this Texas speech stuff. Domdus, in the meantime, he's going to start off on Druid. He's got Keeper of the Grove, an excellent card both ways. The Wrath. Reynad's going to bring out the Handlock. He's not playing the Zoo. That is already surprising to me. I was, as soon as I saw Warlock, I was 95% convinced. You could have won any amount of money from me, TJ. If you had insider knowledge that it was Handlock, I was like, no, it's the Zoo. You're like, no, Dan. I saw the deck list. It's Handlock. I'm like, no, it's Zoo, TJ.
Yeah. Reynad, some people will say Reynad's predictable. I think Reynad is one of the most unpredictable players as far as deck choices go. Because at the last second, he'll just completely change. He'll be leaning towards one thing, and then right before the deck lists are supposed to be submitted, he'll say, you know what, I feel like playing this tomorrow. Or something to that effect. So, I wouldn't put it past him. Now, we talked about this matchup quite extensively earlier. Just how rough this matchup has the potential to be if you're the Handlock player. Because it's so hard sometimes to be able to deal with some early ramp power from Druid. Because a lot of times, you get to the point in the mid to late game, where you're having to constantly play around the possibility of combo.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Although, spending Innervate and Drake here is not exactly the ideal scenario.
No.
It's good that the Drake replaced itself, but a lot of room for it to, I guess, potentially backfire. Now, Reynad's also introduced an interesting choice here. A lot of times, you want to try and see if you can set up the best Drake possible, but against Druid, especially that hits Wild Growth, it's going to be able to silence and hero power it down while leveraging the board.
Yeah.
So it's one of those things where you could tap and set up for the Drake, but if you go for the Owl instead, you're going to be forcing your opponent into a series of decisions where his board is not going to be as strong. Well, Wrath for one.
Yeah, Wrath for one and hero power is not the turn five that Druid is usually pretty happy
right.
with. The way they win is by building up a solid board early on, and then like we were talking about earlier, then putting the threat on with the combo. So, pretty weak turn, I'd say. He is going to be able to clear, but he's not taking initiative.
Right, and now this is where scenario Reynad can see, like, okay, he might have the silence and the hero power, but I have the curve. I have the Twilight Drake into the Sludge Belcher, and then I could tap Farseer, Dr. Boom. Like, that's kind of what he's planning here. Keeper of the Grove is almost a foregone conclusion. That's like the best answer that you could possibly have. Does he want a hero power, or does he want to Wrath for one to draw?
To be honest, I kind of like the Wrath for one here. Even though both Wraths are going to be gone, I wouldn't be happy with the hand that he has right now. It's the only option that he has for a play next turn would be Druid of the Claw, pretty much. Which is okay, but to be honest, I would kind of want to cycle there and try and draw into like Ancient of Lores or maybe in Force of Nature, so you can start having the opportunities to start threatening.
Do you think it matters that he paused, or can Reynad just read into it and be like, well, he had the option of Wrath, so maybe I have to be careful? Like, why would you pause on two mana otherwise?
Yeah.
It's like, you're not going to Wild Growth after going that far.
And you're not going to, like, innervate out a Pilot of Shredder, because then you're leaving a 4-1 on the board that would just trade into it anyway.
I guess it doesn't really matter.
Yep. This maybe could be next level mind
Life
games.
Doesn't matter to you, Jim.
It's all just cards.
I've lost
in the
will to go on. Hold me.
Okay.
So, don't touch me. Azure Drake is also an important thing, too. You just want to. Like, cycling in general is so powerful in this matchup. Just because you have the opportunity to get closer to the kill.
Yeah. I agree. I guess if he. He might have been expecting the to be played on curve there, the Sludge Budger to come down is one of the reasons why he saved the Wrath.
Yeah.
That would be the only explanation that I can think of.
Well, unfortunately, Reynad doesn't have a really strong turn on six mana here. He's got Farseer and Tap, or he's got Dark Bomb plays, and that's not... It's not really particularly good.
No. Either way, he's not going to have enough power to match up on the board with what Domdus has.
But at least Druid hasn't been putting too much pressure. Sometimes it's at this point in the game where you've taken too much damage. It's the tipping point. That's interesting.
Doesn't help much right now. But he could set up for...
It's one of those things, though, if he plays the Farseer, the... Druid of the Claw would trade into the 1-2. The 2-1 goes into the Farseer Hero Power. Yeah, I guess that's okay, because then you can play Dr. Boom. You're healed up to 29, so it's good.
Yeah. You're still not really in any threat for any type of combo play. And even coming up on turn 9, you'll still be in a situation where you can play a big threat like Dr. Boom safely and not have to worry about combo. Because he's just healthy enough.
I like the Ragnaros, by the way, in the Handlock deck. I think there's a lot of ways that you can punish people, especially if someone brings Freeze Mage to format.
Yeah. You know, a lot of players have been cutting a lot of the top end from Handlock.
Yeah.
I think you mentioned that earlier. A lot of players have been tending to go more towards the anti-aggers.
That was you, bro.
Okay. Sure.
I got you, Deej.
Sure.
It was all you.
No, but it is true, because Rags... A lot of times, you don't get to the point where you can play those big threats.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times, your hand is just so clogged with expensive stuff that if you're playing one expensive thing per turn, you're going to fall too far behind against a lot of matchups. Like, what are the two most popular classes right now? Hunter and
Druid. The class that plays Dr. Boom.
And Warrior. Which is every class.
Oh, is that so?
Yes, it is. Oh, Domdus actually has a zombie jail.
Well, actually, I guess Dr. Boom is not that popular in Priest. It's like some people put it in.
Yeah, some people.
But if there's one class that's not like that's sort of
auto-proof,
it's that and maybe Facehunter.
Yeah. It has anti-synergy with Light Bomb. A lot of the lot of the creatures that Priest
put in. It's got perfect synergy for Light Bomb. So you attack with play Dr. Boom on 7, and then you Mind Blast Light Bomb for the win.
Whoa! Next level.
Oh, geez, look at this turn. And that's assuming that these Boombots don't do massive damage, so that Hellfire would be great.
Ooh, those are really inconsequential.
Well, it still helps. Hellfire, double Dark Bomb clears the board.
Yeah, I guess that's okay, because you're at 16 health still, so you're not in the worst-off position.
You gain 5 from the zombie chest.
Oh, yeah, 21. That's right.
21, Dark Bomb. And you have to keep in mind of combo, so you can even tap.
Yeah. I don't really like the Zombie Chow currently too much in Druid.
Mm-hmm.
Just because I don't think the meta is fast enough right now to warrant including Zombie Chow.
It's always one of those things where I feel the same way up until I actually need the Zombie Chow. And I'm like, God dang it. Like, where's my Zombie Chow? Yeah. So it's one of those things where I completely identify with what you're saying, TJ.
Mm-hmm.
Up until the point where you need that zombie chair.
I mean, it sounds weird, but it is it is very true. And then you put in the zombie chow, and then it's always the 28th card in your deck.
Right? And it's like you draw it against Handlock. It's not useful. Domdus really agonizing whether or not he should attack with this Keeper of the Grove. Put in a 17. What can you do on 17? He has Molten Giant, and that's it, and a taunt.
Yeah, he could Molten
Giant.
And
he's wondering about how much damage he'll have if his opponent plays a taunt. That's a lot of Savage Roar damage.
Yeah. And Boom Bots with Savage Roar are super dangerous. Because it has the potential to be a lot more than just whatever the Savage Roar damage shows.
Warning, Boom Bots may explode. Now that's a board clear. Molten Giant, Shadow Flame.
Yep.
As long as he doesn't take too much damage from the Boom Bots. Force of Nature ends this game.
Ooh. Not quite.
Still dangerously close. It's a lot of damage.
Yeah, we haven't actually seen a Force of Nature at all. And we've actually been through not too many cards, but we've been through quite a few. I'm not sure if he runs double Force of Nature and double Saboteur or not.
Mm-hmm.
I think it depends on a lot of the tech cards. You do have to cut something for Zombie Chow. But it's always different. Some players will cut one of the five drops, whether it be like one of the...
Oh, that is so big.
That's sick.
Jeez. All right, so we have...
Twilight Drake.
Molten Giant. And Antique. It's still not out of range.
Oh, you're still dead.
Is he still dead?
19. Yeah, he'd be at 19.
And then 5 plus 4
Oh, well, he'd be dead to Savage Roar. Or Force of Nature.
Yeah.
But okay. it would have to be
he's still dead to, like, on boards. Like,
No.
That's really tough.
Nope.
So it's basically Force of Nature out here, or else he's going to get overrun.
Mm-hmm.
And Perthorison is not it. Now, does he spend time addressing the board? You can Savage Roar down two minions here, the Drake and the Antique Healbot. But that gives up his burst combination. He only has swipe remaining. And Thunderstand's not even that strong. It's just like, it's just kind of like weak. It's a 5-5.
Yeah.
You might as well just play Stranglethorn Tiger. Well, I guess that's one way to say it. That communicates almost everything to Reynad about what he has. It's like, well, I've got nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And Sun Fairy Protector is just nasty. You have Ragnaros. Definitely want to set up some kind of opportunity to just push your opponent out. So Ragnaros Dark Bomb, right?
Yeah, you don't want to give him any opportunity. You don't want to leave it up to a rag coin flip here. And it's basically gonna lock him out of a game because you would have to use Force of Nature Savage Roar the next turn if he drew it to clear, or he'd be dead the following turn just from.
Or the alternative is like one of those things where you have Force of Nature Savage Roar. And like, well, okay, I thought he was going to go for Dark Bomb, but if he's going to taunt both of these, then it's like Force Nature Savage Roar to the face and hope you draw, like, Drew the Claw. And he shoots down Thorsen just for extra measure.
Mm. Oh, one
card off from lethal. Domdus is devastated.
That's brutal.
If Reynad is being able to see his face, he knew exactly what his opponent drew.
Yeah, Reynad just sips his tea like, yep, just Reynad things.
For justice.
Yeah, for justice.
There's one thing that Reynad wants to fight. It's for sweet karma. Nothing feels quite like shutting down the Force of Nature Savage Roar combo, but heartbreaking moment for Domdus.
Yeah, Reynad's not even looking. He's like, I know exactly what's going to come into his hand.
Yeah. Oh, man. Well, it's like, what do you even do? You just kind of roll over.
Yeah.
Poor Domdus. And now Reynad's one damage off lethal.
And, what happened with the board?
I have no idea.
Can he even...
No board, no cards.
Yeah.
All right, so he's going to definitely just straight up tap.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
Mm-hmm. This game is all but over. There's no outs for Domdus here. I wouldn't even stay in the game at this point. If only because... the loser has
the lower secrecy advantage. Shows more cards in general.
Like, I don't know if you even want to show him scenarios in this case.
Fair enough.
But, I mean, it will probably not mean anything. There are druids that choose to run like a rag instead of scenarios, but there's very rare situations where you're like, well, I'm going to play around scenarios right here. I mean, I guess maybe clearing off an extra creature from the board in a situation where you could be lethal, where you could be dead and he only has one card in his hand.
Ooh, silence in your own rag. I like it.
Indeed.
Pow! Game's over. Reynad takes a 1-0 lead. Domdus kind of falling a little bit short, unfortunately, with that druid deck. Pretty tough to swallow, too, considering that he was so close, so many turns, and just needed to draw that force of nature.
One card away.
Yeah, it's not how you play druid. He got the first half right, draw wild growth and you know, get the keeper of the growth, but he didn't get the second half right, draw on part two of the combo. It's tough.
Yeah, we don't know yet if he runs double piece of the combo. I think he only had like 10 cards left.
Sure, it's pretty unlucky if he has two Force of Natures, because he had so much cantrip in his deck. He had the Azure Drakes.
Yeah.
And the Ancient of the Lords, he just really dig deeper. He wild growth again on 10 mana to draw another card.
Like, cycled a lot.
Things. Yeah.
Cycled a lot. So it is.
It happens. It's Hearthstone.
Yeah. It is Hearthstone. That is correct. Well, Reynad still has Druid and Warrior left. I think you're a little bit closer to Reynad than I am at the current moment.
Some would say.
Yeah. His house is in that direction.
Somewhere like that. I mean, he's in Huntington Beach, so that's like an hour from us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's a pretty nice place. But do you think he'd play Grim Patron Warrior or Control Warrior?
Yeah, I think there's a realistic chance he might play both. It would be one of those things where, I thought he was going to bring Zoo, because I thought people just thought Zoo was strictly better. But in the current metagame. But if it's one of those things where Reyna's like, yeah, you know what, maybe everyone's playing Grim Patron Warrior, I should just bring Control Warrior to kill it, because that's one of the very few counters to Grim Patron Warrior, which is ironically its own class. I don't know. If he plays Grim Patron Warrior, then great. It's awesome against Paladin. There's so many 1-1s that you can tackle against.
Yeah. On the other hand,
if it's Control Warrior,
it's got some issues. Because
it better be Dragon Warrior, so that way you have like a bunch of ways to fight against Paladin that are unconventional. Mm-hmm. Grinding them out through other normal Control Warrior cards like Shield Maiden is not going to do the trick.
No.
Gotta use the Blackwing Corruptors and the Nefarian.
In the era a couple months ago where mid-range Paladin was really popular, it was considered one of the stronger matchups against Control Warrior. And this does not tell us anything. That still does not tell us anything. Because there are some players that put Paladin Shredder in both Control Warrior and in the Grim Patron Warrior.
I would lean towards the Patron Warrior for Pilot Shredder because it's stickier and it's more prevalent to getting the damage and board presence. I kind of liked Pilot Shredder over the Gnomish for a while because it's just such good board presence. It's almost too good to pass up. It's one of those things where Pilot Shredder is just so potent for its mana slot that you just have to kind of throw it in there. This is a great hand, by the way. I don't know what he would want to
change.
Fantastic. Yeah. If I was Domdus, I'd just be like, ah, God, he chose to stick with everything.
Yeah. And that's exactly his face right there. Oh, God.
Okay.
Oh, God.
Yeah, that's exactly his expression.
Domdus doesn't have that terrible of a curve as well. I mean, he's got Mustard for Battle Quartermaster combo. The thing is, can he get to the point where that's going to be useful? Especially now with the Whirlwind.
Right.
Going to stop Mustard for Battle in its tracks.
Oh, cool Taskmaster. That's interesting. That's very meta for me.
Yeah.
That is so Reynad.
There's been a lot of times where I've actually thought about doing this, but there's never been a time where I've actually done it.
Against the Shielded Mini-Bot?
Yeah.
All right.
I mean, if you think about it, either way, you're taking 4 damage. Because if you use Fire War Axe in that scenario, you're taking... end up taking 6 damage. Because you'd attack into it would attack into you back, you'd attack into it again. This way, you're actually only taking 4 because you're trading it. You're still only using 1 card. It's whether or not you value the Cruel Taskmaster over the Fiery War Axe.
It kind of works brilliantly in this scenario. He's going to shut it down with Acolyte Whirlwind. Oh, my God.
That
was really smart.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, again, one of these things, a lot of players are saying Reynad's playing really well. It's just his deck preparation. So, I think this is a really good example of, that was something that was not very intuitive, but pretty sweet. A lot of people probably would have just coined out Acolyte. you know, attack the shield, whirlwind, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, you coin out the Acolyte and then use the Fireworks the next turn after you get a card draw.
Right. Now he gets guaranteed at least one draw. Maybe the owl will shut it down.
And in the end, he still would have taken the same amount of damage, to be completely honest.
Second Acolyte is excellent, too, because I think the first one's about to... I think you want to deny the card draw. It's so important as a combo deck. But then, the argument against the owl was that there was no good follow-up play. But now that he's shielded Minibot, you might be able to justify the owl.
And if you use the owl now, there's a lot of actually really crucial targets that need to be silenced in this Patron Warrior deck, especially if you're a paladin. Mm-hmm. Because it's so hard for you to guarantee a spot where you can clear off Patron Warriors successfully, unless you have like Azure Drake Consecration combo, which this just looks like a straight up mid-range paladin. It doesn't look like it's any sort of variation of Dragon Paladin where you'd run double Azure Drake. So, this hand for Reynad is actually pretty insane.
Two Grim Patrons.
They're literally Patron Warriors.
They kind of are, man.
Well, they define the deck, so I mean...
They're the win condition. He has both of them. He just needs to pick up Warsong Commander. I think silencing the Acolyte was so big because if his opponent had the weapon on the Pilot Shredder and it had a one attack minion come up, it would have just been such bad news.
Mm-hmm.
But Reynad, of course, setting up with a good Death Bite opportunity. Definitely what he wants here. And he has a good backup option both ways. He can draw cards or set up more patrons.
Yeah. I think with double Grim Patron in hand, you want to try and get him out as quick as possible. The one risk that you take is, what if a 3-attack creature comes out of that Pilot Shredder? Because you don't get to check before you play the Grim Patron.
It's still almost too good. You have two patrons as well.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. The other option here is to use Acolyte of Pain and then throw out the Unstable Ghoul. Where you're almost guaranteeing you get two draws. And you could put out Grim Patron and trade your Unstable Ghoul in the next turn to get the automatic. It's going to be big. Whatever comes out of this Pilot Shredder, it's 2-attack or less.
What? Oh, that's not good or ideal.
It's not ideal for either player.
Yeah.
It's just awkward for both.
It's the Grim Patron is much more minion based than spell based. There's draw cards like and there's execute. That's pretty much it, right?
I think the
Whirlwind.
Whirlwind, Inner Rage, Execute, Slam sometimes.
Yeah, but like how much are those useful against Grim Patron? It's like, oh, I gave you Whirlwind. It's like, oh yeah, I guess I'll use that on your board of Patron. Like, who cares? Alright, one thing Reynad has to also be mindful of is he can't lose too much health. I know he's been playing around with it. Wow!
He's at 12, and there's actually a Dr. Boom.
That is the perfect scenario. Drop the Pilot Shredder, right? And then just start hamming away.
Yep. And Dr. Boom can actually be somewhat of a liability as well.
The Boombots?
The Boombots, yeah.
I mean, they're a heavy liability at that stage.
Yeah. You can hope for the best with Boombots to the face. But that's really hoping for the best. And Domdus has some health to work with. But your health doesn't really go that far against Patron Warrior. At least you can't assume that your health is going to go very far. Because you just think he has Warsong Commander, Frog and Berserker, Whirlwind in his hand, you're dead.
That's a good point.
All right.
How do you do this? Do you want to kill off Dr. Boom first and then attack with the 3-3? How much damage do you also have? You have 4, 10, 13. Okay.
Not really close.
Well, I was wondering if, you know, he could guarantee pick off something, Warsong Commander or something. He could do some really big shenanigans. But there's no way to draw into that, guaranteed.
Yeah.
Unless this hits the Acolyte for, like, 1 to 3.
Yeah, I mean, there's...
And he draws Warsong Commander.
There's a lot of good outcomes here for Reynad. That's... I wouldn't say good. Because his health is probably his most precious resource right now. Because it's so low. Unless he's planning on killing off the Dr. Boom, he doesn't want these Boombots to go face. He wants them to go into the Acolyte or...
Right.
To spawn more Grim Patrons. Hit another Grim Patron for one. But with the hit the face, he realizes that he needs to clear off the Boom immediately. That one goes to phase 2!
Yeah, but... It's still 8 damage, and he doesn't have, like, as the against a paladin, I think like the threshold's 7. 7 might as well be 30 against paladin sometimes.
That's really big draw.
The equality. But he also gives it to his opponent.
I don't think it really actually, no, it actually does matter.
It kind of does.
But there's still a lower Arcacho on the board.
I know.
So it's if he uses it, he gives it back.
Well, he just kills it with the weapon.
Oh, that's true. That's true.
Well, he's going to play Emperor Thorazin first and then hit armor up.
Yeah. But that's big.
Really amusing to me.
Because it gets rid of the Grim Pain. Oh, no.
Oh, I forgot the
Unstable Ghoul.
Lord Walker Cho died for your sins, Reynad. Oh, my goodness. Okay.
This can still be Domdus' game if he draws into like a true Silver Champion.
Right.
And Reynad can't find a way to piece together a lethal in the next couple turns.
Well, he's got a lot of room to work with here.
Yeah.
Dropping Thorazin seems to be the best play. I think it's about if he wants a cool task or just armor up. If his opponent has... he's going to go for Deathbite. Okay. Deathbite sets up for the better Emperor play with Battle Rage.
Yeah.
And also gets more damage out. And he gets to still cool task and armor up. So he's going to play the most safe possible.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where he's like, he's so far ahead that he just doesn't want to die to anything stupid. And then, of course, this is where Domdus rips Ragnaros, right? It just surprises him. Ah, too bad.
Yeah, Sludge Belcher is really not that great because he's just going to die to the second iteration of Sludge Belcher. But, right. I mean, he'd have to take 3 damage, or second iteration of Deathbite, sorry. He'd still have to take 3 damage in order to clear it off. And, I mean, he can Knife Juggler... then Sludge Belcher hero power, and all of a sudden you have a Knife Juggler that's hiding behind a Sludge Belcher.
It's so scary, too, because you know your opponent has Equality Consecration as the warrior.
Yep. It's a very weird...
God, it doesn't matter what you do with Quartermaster.
People are just tuning in now. They're like, what the...
What just
Grim
happened?
Grim Patron Warrior
like
just got
stronger.
It's like,
playing Nefarian. He's playing Nefarian in Grim Patron Warrior. It's like, you're absolutely correct.
That could be the conclusion that people jump to.
Mm-hmm.
And it's weird that... I thought Reynad had, like, an all-golden collection, but he doesn't have golden Grim Patron Warriors.
Hold on. Okay, so he's got Warsong Commander. How does he do this?
I mean, he can just clear the board with Warsong Commander, Grim Patron.
That's fair.
But he risks putting himself at 4 health. Because if the juggle from the slime hits his face, he takes 3 damage plus 1 juggle. He'll take 4 damage total. He'll be at 4 health. I mean, it's a slight risk.
I think it's something worth taking.
Yeah, but what other options do you have? You can Equality Consecrate and then hit in, but that's not that strong of a play.
The alternative is to hit it and then Consecrate, I guess, or something. He's got a lot of chances to survive.
On the other hand, if this juggle hits a Grim Patron, that's just one extra Grim Patron.
Ooh. No.
Nope. That gets rid of the True Silver possibility.
Yeah, so it's 5 damage, a little bit off. And that means Domdus needs to draw something high impact now. Lay on Hands? No, Peacekeeper's not going to do anything. And there's still Battle Rage. This is so bad. I think this is it. You can't actually pull out from here.
No, because Paladin doesn't have Burst. So he would need at least 2 turns to be able to close this one out. Because basically he needed True Silver right then.
And he needed to be fortuitous off the hit. You know, it's...
Yeah.
Like, even if you hit him in the face, he could armor smith and then do, like, some whirlwind effects and then gain a bunch of armor.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think there's a way out. I mean, you play Eldar Peacekeeper on one of these Grim Patrons. It basically trades for one patron.
Right, but you're afraid of hero powering. You have to, like, play that with Quartermaster, then Quartermaster becomes a liability.
Oh, and that just gets rid of any possibility that Domdus would have, except for Rag.
Except for Rag.
Don't even know if he runs that. I mean, a lot of mid-range paladins don't run Ragnaros. That's not a normal card.
Tough. Really tough. Fiery War Axe pickup. Fiery War Axe means if he chops it, then his opponent still might have Silence and True Silver.
Yeah.
So many, I have to just make sure not to die under any scenario. So slam. Slams are reasonable.
I mean, he could even just Sludge Belcher armor up.
Do you slam your own Grim Patron so that you do generate a 3-3? I guess so.
Yeah, might as well.
And then suicide the 3-2 win.
I think that's game with the Whirlwind.
Oh, that's right.
Wait, no, because its Grim Patrons won't get charged. Because
no, it summons would charge first before it dies.
Oh, okay,
right?
Okay, yeah.
Oh, actually, you're right.
Reynad doesn't know.
Yeah.
Look at his face.
He's not sure. He's like, oh my god, do I have lethal? He's like, oh my god, do I have lethal? You have to go now, man.
You can tell that Reynad doesn't have as much experience because his Grim Patrons aren't golden. Every other card he has is golden.
No, he had it. All right. Oh, wait.
Oh, he still has
charge.
It. No, he doesn't. He's one man off.
No. Oh, my God. Okay, the truce overcame. So this game, I mean, we're right? Like, we're correct? Look, Grim Patron is still a new deck, man. I'm pretty sure if the Warsong dies still, it still gives it charge.
I've played a lot of Grim Patron Warrior games, and I've never run into that scenario where my Warlord would kill off my...
I'm pretty sure it's like the same as, like, Armorsmith. If it dies at the same time...
It's like with Flamestrike
right,
or with Blade
it still,
Flurry,
gives
still gives
it
the
off
armor.
The activation of its ability.
With the, I mean, there are some rules
like,
that
I'm pretty sure that's the sequence.
Yeah.
Okay.
But, again, inconsequential. He still
wins.
But his face gave it away. Oh, man.
He was just, like, thinking about the possibility of missing lethal. But you know what? Sludge Belcher is just
if I whirlwind and my Grim Patrons don't get charged, am I going to look like an idiot? I'm just going to play
the
Sludge Belcher.
The answer is yes.
All right, well, Reynad takes a 2-0 lead. So he's out to a really great start. He's only got Druid left to win with.
Yeah, but that's a tall order, man. There's Paladin remaining. There's the Grim Patron Warrior.
Well, we don't.
And then there's the Warlock.
We don't know.
Oh, not the Warlock. Sorry, the Druid itself.
We don't know if it's Grim Patron Warrior yet. We haven't yet seen Domdus' Warrior. I mean, we can assume.
That's true. But I think Grim Patron Warrior is just so strong. Mutually agreed to be one of the best.
It breaks my little heart.
Why does it break your heart?
You know how I am with Control Warrior. To see another warrior deck take over,
that as you've played hundreds of games of Patron Warrior.
Yeah, but that doesn't match up anywhere near to the thousands of games of Control Warrior that I played. But I mean,
you're the one being unfaithful.
I play the Patron Warrior so I can learn it, so I can speak more intelligently about it. I don't play it because
you like it.
I play it because it's my job. Well,
wow, TJ,
it's like
it's all business with you, huh?
It's all business, no pleasure.
God. You are the worst person to interview at customs.
Yep. That's why every time I go to the airport to fly another country, I get held for 24 hours.
It's not because you look like...
Chuck Liddell.
I'm not going to say. It's not because you look like Chuck Liddell, the Iceman. Have you ever been confused for Chuck Liddell?
No.
Man.
No, that's why I get a 2 on the sides instead of a 0.
Yeah, I guess. Fair enough. Mm-hmm. And also, you have way more muscles than him.
And friendlier eyes.
Druid versus Paladin is a matchup that still, I feel like, goes in the favor of Paladin.
Yeah.
Never count out the fact that Druid has 3 chances to draw Wild Growth into, like, the perfect curve.
Yeah.
Generally speaking, this is the position where people have figured out with Druid and Conquest. You can get out to a 2-0 lead, and then Druid just has to
find Wild Growth one game.
No, it's true. It's the fact that it's, like, even though it's not as strong against the field of decks as it normally is. It's like one game you have to get the good curve. It's just how it is.
Mm-hmm.
The statistical chance of you never having a strong opening hand in 3 games with the Druid is very low.
This is a pretty good hand for Domdus, I'd say.
That's excellent. He's got Knife Juggler, Muster for Battle, and 2 Pilot Shredder.
He's also got Peacekeeper, which is, I think, a fantastic card against Druid in general.
Right. I think so, too.
Nope.
Turn 2 pass from Reynad. It's not a very good sign.
We're currently role-playing as Domdus until we get the spectate mode back up for Reynad's Druid here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, Domdus has a strong curve. And he gets wild, and Reynad gets Wild Growth. So I guess he drew it off the top.
Yeah.
Better late than ever, I guess.
Yeah. Now, the one thing that Domdus has to hope is that there's no swipe here. I mean, he's still putting on pressure, and swipe gives him the opportunity. He still has initiative. He'll be able to play Power Shredder next turn, but on the other hand, if Reynad doesn't have swipe, he's in a whole lot of trouble.
Yeah, he's just going to be under a lot of punishment from the damage. You don't really expect too much, but you know, as it turns out, just these 1-1s add up very quickly.
Mm-hmm. Especially, he's already at 24 health. Oh, there is a swipe. Oh. Okay.
Yeah, there's a swipe, and there's also
Ancient of Wars.
Yeah, Ancient of Wars. So he's playing Ramp Druid.
I think a lot of...
Where is he playing Ramp Druid? No, he's playing just taunts. Just like Druid with taunts.
Yeah. I've heard a lot of players say that Ancient of Lore, trying to fit in Ancient of Wars into just a standard Ramp Druid, maybe cutting one combo or cutting something else in like the 5-slot area, playing Ancient of Wars is actually really strong right now.
What the heck? You know, if he picks up Emperor Thorazin, by turn 9, he'll do 22 damage from the hit.
Yeah. That's ridiculous. Yeah. Ancient of War stops Patron Warrior in its tracks, basically. Ancient of War is just
execute.
There's execute, but, I mean, a lot of times they're using execute on creatures that are played a little bit earlier than that because they're not expecting an Ancient of War.
That's fair.
Well, right now. I mean, if it becomes standard in mid-range Druid or Ramp Druid or, I mean, been given so many names, does Ancient of War change its identity? Who knows? But once people start expecting it, then they might save execute. But usually it's used on like a Druid of the Claw or even something like an Azure Drake early on in the game to buy you some time.
Yeah, it's fair. Oh man, does he pay the life here? I don't think so. If he attacks into this 4-6, what does he gain?
Potentially not much, but potentially a lot. I know that's really ambiguous, but if it's tough to say, because what if he gets something that's bad from that polisher that works against him?
Right. Oh, I thought it was with the weapon that he was evaluating if he should.
Oh, okay. I thought you meant with the Powder Shredder.
You're right, though.
I don't think there's really any need to take damage over a couple turns.
Is there any merit to attacking into it?
I don't think so. Because you're basically telling your opponent that you're going to take 8 damage over the next 2 turns. Because the only reason you do that is to try and trade just Powder Shredder and attacking in. The cog.
That's not too bad.
Hammer.
Although, would you rather just deal 15 damage or 14? Yeah, 14 damage through equality.
I like that. And the equality is working a lot more in your favor in this scenario because Paladin Shredder and Sludge Belcher being reduced to 1 health is not the worst thing in the world. Still gonna be something that comes out of it. Domus is in such a dominating position right now. Second Ancient of War.
Yep.
That's pretty good.
And immediately dropping it down, but is there a way for him to push through here? I guess you can just use the Peacekeeper on it.
It's a good thing he didn't uproot it.
Yeah, because the Big Game Hunter?
Yeah.
Oh, you mean the Peacekeeper.
Just because it's uproot. There doesn't even have to be a counter on the other end. Just the fact that
it's uproot. Dude, you laugh, but I've won a few games recently uprooting my Ancient of War against Hunter.
You say you would have lost that game if you didn't uproot it?
Yeah. I wouldn't have enough damage.
Even with a 5-10 taunt on the board?
Yeah.
Okay.
I had to race him.
Okay.
I also really, really wanted to hit him in the face with an uprooted Ancient War. I've been just having this craving of hitting people in the face with minions that are big, like Fel Reaver and Ancient of War. I even started... Like, one time I got a Core Hound, and I had, what was the other? Silverback Patriarch, and he couldn't get through it, and I had the Core Hound in the face. And I think I peed a little bit. I was really excited, man.
Yeah, I've never hit face with an uprooted Ancient of War, so I don't really know how it feels.
He doesn't develop the... he doesn't develop the Cog Hammer.
Yeah, I was expecting either that or the Eldar Peacekeeper. But, I mean, I guess there's really not a rush, especially if he's playing the Lothep here.
Right. So, now Reynad has an interesting predicament, because the Keeper of the Grove is ideal to keep for Tyrion, but he might want to play it now.
That is Reynad's interesting predicament pose.
Yeah. I don't know exactly what's the best, to be honest, in this situation. Use the Keeper of the Grove just to deal damage and kill off the 1-2, or, you know, just necessarily pushing through, killing off Lotheb.
He's got double combo next turn.
This is an instance where, because your opponent pretended like he has no way to deal with the Ancient of War, it, like, forces your opponent to, like, play more into the fact that he can't get through it, and now a Peacekeeper can run through it easily.
If you're going to have any four cards in your hand on turn 10, these are the four cards.
Oh my god, you're right.
Double combo.
I forgot he had Innervate.
If one creature survives on the board,
that's game.
He would need an extra 6 damage. It's 22. Double combo by itself is 22.
So anything with 2 attack or more.
Anything with 2 attack or more.
And so, assuming he doesn't use his weapon to just hit into something.
Yeah, well, I mean, if he uses his weapon, then he's also getting a taunt, which would put a literal wrench in his plans.
Well, I foresee him using, the Peacekeeper for sure, and I really thought he might want to consider using the Quartermaster here. Because it's just better pressure onto the board.
Yep.
But he's about to get slammed in the face!
Yeah, he's not going to clear. There's no way he can clear off anything. That's it.
Reynad's about to give the world's biggest metaphorical wedgie to Domdus.
an innervate hero power for good measure.
He can.
Oh my
he
goodness!
He can innervate another hero power.
Yeah.
That is soul crushing.
Yeah.
And Domdus gets 3-0'd just by a series of unfortuitous plays and draws.
Oh man.
Just ridiculous.
And he does innervate out the hero power. That's like 4 damage overkill. Is that 31 damage that he just did?
Let's see. That's game.
That's
goes
even more damage.
He goes to the winner's match.
Wow.
And there it is.
Wow.
Poor Domdus, man. That was...
And 3-0 as well.
That was a thrashing.
Mm-hmm. The Paladin deck not really doing much. It seemed pretty unsuccessful right there. But of course, Reynad, he did play really well. I mean, we go back to that first game where he made that play with that cruel Taskmaster. Which,
that was pretty cool, man.
Yeah.
Because it set up almost everything else.
Mm-hmm, yeah, it did.
It's like, well, Muster for Battle is a little bit better in this scenario because you can't just pick it off and the 2-2 challenges the 1-1. Yeah, let's do it. And then it's just... All right, and it worked out exactly how it panned out. So, well done to Reynaldo. Domdus is not out of it yet. I was actually kind of disappointed because I like Paladin nowadays, and I think it's great. It's just that, like we mentioned, it's weak against the Grim Patron Warrior. Even if things go, a little bit awry, it's like really hard for you to climb back in the game.
Yeah, unless you have overwhelming presence early, it's just super, super hard. But Domdus will go on to face Bunny Muffins in the Losers Match Group B. But even if he loses, he won't get a chance to make the Legendary Series this way, but he will have a chance with the Redemption Tournament. Next week, May 14th, 15th, 16th, and 17th, all the players that competed in the Legendary Series weeks but did not win, so 7 players each week, will be put into 4-7 separate 7-player brackets. And, of course, the winner of each of those brackets will move on to the $25,000 Legendary Series LAN.
June
5th through 7th.
We're going to be
really
there, TJ.
We are going to be there.
At the LAN. We have some fun stuff planned.
They're keeping me in the dark about the fun stuff.
Oh, they're not telling you.
Mm-mm.
Well, it may or may not involve water and balls hitting the tank.
Okay.
Yeah, you knew what I meant.
Yeah, yeah. I knew exactly.
We're having a TJ tank.
Yeah.
Where if,